In this sixth and last presentation, we will discuss how the various physiological processes we have discussed earlier can be joined into a single model of the cardiovascular system. By doing so, we hope to increase your understanding of the system with all of its complexities. Based upon the previous presentations, Neuermann has developed a model for cardiovascular simulation. The fundamentals of the model are based upon the assumption that we need to consider blood volume and not blood pressure. So the model of the heart is a simple volume pump, taking time to fill and then ejecting its volume into the aorta, irrespective of the prevailing pressure. Thereby, the heart follows the Frank-Starling mechanism. The cardiovascular system is modeled as a branching series of capacitances connected by resistances. When a certain blood volume is injected into the farmost left capacitance, it has three options: either remain in this capacitance or flow over a resistance into one or both capacitances to the right. Similarly, the blood flowing into the middle capacitances can either remain there or flow over the next resistances to the capacitances further to the right. All blood is collected by the venous system in the model of the large capacitance at the right. The model does not contain the small circulation through the lungs, but instead models heart and lungs together as a simple system of blood refreshment. Refreshing the blood means increasing oxygen content and reducing carbon dioxide. The model will graph optimally refreshed blood as bright red, but blood with low oxygen and high carbon dioxide as blue. Before diving into the possibilities of the cardiovascular model, it is important to stress what are its limits and what are its advantages. Please understand that a model is not a simulation of reality. Instead, it is an animated theory. A model like this helps to better understand the interplay between different physiological processes acting simultaneously. As said, let's keep things simple. The heart is modeled as a volume pump, simply ejecting the amount of blood collected during the filling time. When heart rate is high, the filling time is small and stroke volume is relatively small. However, when heart rate is low, filling time is long and stroke volume becomes large. In this example, we have increased metabolism in the body, simulating, for instance, increased work during sport activity or during physical labor. It shows the difference in the receiving venous compartment at the far right. At the top, the brain compartment with normal metabolic activity coloring red, and below the body compartment coloring blue because of the increased metabolic activity. The second thing to understand about the model is that arterial blood pressure is a result and not the aim of heart contraction. The aim of heart contraction is to bring the blood volume into motion. Pumping the blood volume from the low venous pressure to the high arterial pressure adds potential energy to the blood, allowing it to flow through all the body's capillary systems. Of course, the model also contains a simulation of the theory of arterial acceleration, formulated in 2014. This theory proposes that during early systole, the force of ventricular contraction is augmented and propagated along the arterial tree by a brief arterial vasoconstriction. In the model, this effect is simulated by a temporary reduction of all arterial capacitances with around 5% for a period of 0.1 second. The blood ejected by the heart can to a lesser extent linger in the capacitances, but instead is forced along the arterial tree into the capillary systems. As we shall see, this increases the pulsatility in the arterioles. In this video, we start without arterial acceleration. This gives a dampened flow velocity curve to the brain as well as to the body. These velocity curves, as a function of time, are given above and below the heart. These are the graphical representation of the flow over the end resistances at the far right. The upper one for resistance number 7 leading to capillaries of the brain, the bottom one for resistance number 9 leading to capillaries in the periphery. While we are talking, the arterial acceleration is gradually increased, at first leading to a small shoulder during early systole. When the strength of the arterial acceleration is increased, this shoulder becomes a distinctive peak or SYS1, preceding the peak of the ejection phase of the heart, SYS2. Eventually, the SYS1 is much larger than SYS2, a situation that can, for instance, occur during hyperventilation. In this video, we simulate the flow velocities in brain and systemic circulation under normal circumstances at a heart rate of 70 bpm during normal ventilation and rest with the subject recumbent. For this simulation, we have increased the metabolic rate of the brain. Note the blue color in the top venous compartment. Now also note the cardiac output, which amounts 7.1 liters per minute. Because of the increased metabolic activity, our aim is to increase cardiac output. First, we try increasing the heart rate to 100 bpm. That happens about here. However, this does not increase cardiac output, but instead it decreases to 6.8 liters per minute. This is because there is less filling time of the heart. In order to raise cardiac output, we have finally decreased venous capacitance. This makes cardiac output increase to 9.6 liters per minute. Because the backflow to the heart is increased, over a longer period of time, the decrease in venous capacitance causes a shift in blood volume from venous towards arterial side, which causes arterial blood pressure to rise. The model shows this in the middle right part of the simulation window. The arterial blood pressure becomes 175 over 93. In this way, the model can mimic the CNS ischemic response. In the model, the venous capacitance is controlled by a linear function which decreases the venous capacitance in response to a decrease in blood oxygen or an increase in blood carbon dioxide. The CNS ischemic response allows the organism to shift its blood towards the arterial system and thereby increase cardiac output in response to an increase in metabolic demand. In the model, the CNS ischemic response can be activated by selecting the checkbox in the upper right corner of the simulation window. Now venous capacitance will adapt automatically in response to changes in metabolism. Note how, as a result, cardiac output changes with metabolic activity. Here we are changing the metabolic activity of the systemic circulation, decreasing it, which would allow the venous capacitance to become larger and cardiac output to become lower. One of the first indications that there are two distinctive phases during systole was the observation that during cardiac arrhythmia there is more variation in the SYS2 than in the SYS1 component. For instance, this can be observed during deep breathing, 5 seconds of deep inhalation followed by 5 seconds of deep expiration. The graph shows the difference in flow profile after bin averaging several heartbeats selected by heart rate. This effect can easily be simulated by varying cardiac arrhythmia in the cardiovascular simulation model. Note how the shape of the systolic part of the flow curve varies with the varying heart rate. In the model, the varying heart rate will cause differences in stroke volume that are expressed in the SYS2 component but not in the SYS1 component, since the SYS1 does not depend on stroke volume but only on the strength of the arterial acceleration. In the flow graph, at the upper left, we can see how the difference between SYS1 and SYS2 varies over the respiratory cycle. Metabolic coupling is a mechanism by which the diameter of the arterioles adapts to differences in local regional metabolism. For instance, in the brain, the arterioles open up when a brain region becomes more active and closes when the same region decreases its activity. In the cardiovascular model, we have built these reflexes in by entering a linear relationship between local metabolism and local resistances. In this video, the intracranial and extracranial autoregulation have been activated, together with the CNS ischemic response. Note how the flow pattern changes in response to differences in metabolism. First, we change the intracranial metabolism. In the model, this will not only change the cerebrovascular resistance, but also directly influence the venous capacitance via the CNS ischemic response. When changing the systemic metabolism, the effect of the CNS ischemic response occurs later due to the circulation time. In the model, the blood pressure first drops due to a widespread decrease in systemic resistance, only to be followed by an increase once the CNS ischemic response becomes active. In the model, the CNS ischemic response is very powerful and corrects for any change in metabolic demand. Together with intracranial and extracranial autoregulation, these responses stabilize arterial blood pressure. To show more elements of the cardiovascular model, in this video, the effect of the tilt table test is simulated. Now all reflexes have been turned on, apart from the Bainbridge response. This means that a baroreceptor reflex has been added that influences heart rate as well as peripheral resistance. The baroreceptor reflex allows the cardiovascular system to respond swiftly to, for instance, changes in body posture. Due to the vertical tilt, hydrostatic pressure will tend to shift the blood volume from the upper to the lower part of the body. All reflexes work together to maintain adequate blood supply to the brain. If these mechanisms fail, blood flow to the brain may be impeded, possibly causing a transient loss of consciousness. As we have seen, the cardiovascular model is an animation of how different physiological processes may, in theory, work together to ensure adequate blood supply to all tissues within the body, because that is the purpose of the cardiovascular system, adapting and adjusting itself so that blood volume is directed towards body parts who, due to their metabolic activity, need it most, yet without skipping those body parts that are temporarily less metabolically active and thus less demanding for blood supply. By joining all these aspects within a single model, we hope to increase your understanding of the many processes underlying the cardiovascular system with all of its complexities. And a better understanding leads to better observation. We thank you for your attention.